Yeah, there we go.
All right, don't kick that. So, as I was saying, some people really feel good at footnotes. They can contact me and we do that instead of a paper with them. But they have to know a lot about the subject to do that. And speak to me at the end of the class, if you're really interested, I would question you about your expertise. We were talking about, I think it's really important that I read those passages about the people who are worse than the thugs, or actually join forces with the thugs and the thieves or bandits and the innovators. These were the imposters claiming divine inspiration, leading the people out into the wilderness, there to show them the signs of their coming redemption. Who said that? Josephus. I read it three passages from you the last time. Josephus. Why? So, I mean, from Josephus' mouth, that means these people existed. There were people like that who were doing that kind of thing. And that would be the period, particularly in the 40s, 50s, and 60s before the fall of the temple. He's more insistent on that kind of condemnation as we get closer to the time of the uprising against Rome. And he gets extremely emotional about it. And it's not just two such references to it. There's about three or four in both of his works. I didn't bring my antiquities. Next time I'll bring it. I didn't think we needed it. But I will read you his the interpolated section about Jesus and the antiquities next time if I bring it. Anyone have an antiquities here? I'll read it now if you do. But if you don't, I'll bring it next time. There is a section about Jesus, not in the Jewish War. You see, the Jewish War is really weird. It talks about problems in Samaria, the brutality of Pontius Pilate. There, he crucifies a Samaritan messianic leader who was trying to show the signs. Someone that in Samaritan history thereafter is called the Taheb. No one knows the actual derivation for that, but it's sort of considered to be the restorer. And he's crucified by Pontius Pilate. That's actually in the war. But there's nothing about Jesus in the war. There's something about some problems in Rome between some people called Mundus and Paulina, very odd episode. Around the time that you would expect the Jesus episode in under Pontius Pilate. Now don't forget, this is written in the 70s. That's very early. So if there was something important, he's either covering it over or he should have told us. And then he says about this Mundus and Paulina that there was a fellow, I don't forget the whole episode, but there was a fellow who wanted to seduce a Roman matron in Rome. Matrons being apparently more interested in religious things, as they have been often throughout history, than the men. And he, you know, there are a lot of cults in Rome, and he impersonated the god Anubis, an Egyptian god, and went into one of those shrines in Rome honoring this particular god, or son of God, or whatever, and then, you know, encouraged or convinced the lady to come into the shrine and seduced her. Very odd stuff there. And then the Roman emperor of the time, who it seems to be was either, I think it was Claudius, or it was Tiberius, one of the two, expelled all the Jews from Rome. Also because two other Jews were kind of like apostle-type figures raising money on some pretext to send back to the Holy Land and were cheating people of their funds or something. So for these two causes, I think it was Claudius banished the Jews from Rome, supposedly. That would be in the early 40s. He mentions that, but it must be early because it's under Pontius Pilate, so it must be in the 30s. Anyway, my memory, I don't have the book in front of me, so my memory escapes me. And those are very odd episodes, and they have a lot of themes that are sort of motifs that we find in the early Christian material. So one wonders, why did he put that in? Was there something else under there that he was implying, or what was going on? The Jews didn't stay expelled from Rome anyway. In Suetonius, the Roman historian of the 12th season, it says that the Jews were expelled from Rome for making propaganda on behalf of one Crescens. Suetonius is writing about 100 AD. And I think, again, that is in the period of either Tiberius or Claudius. The Jews were expelling Claudius. My memory, it's in my books. Just have to look up Crestus and you'll find the actual note in my James book. You know, I've got very good indexes in those books. People like Ron and others helped me with that. And we all worked very hard on those indexes. 30 or 40 pages of indexes are not what you usually find in books. So you can actually find anything you want if you look things up carefully in the index in those books. So Crestus, obviously the point is here something to do with Christ. But you see, even in 100 AD, writers like Suetonius did not distinguish between Jews and Christians. You know, no one knew the difference at that point. And I think you could translate that by saying they were expelled from Rome because of messianic agitation. Messianic agitation. So the Jews always catch it both ways. They catch it for supposedly persecuting the Messiah and for being messianic. You know, they can't win, but they lose. Whichever side is looking at it, you know, socks it to them. The Christian side socks it to them because they don't agree with their theological point of view. The Roman side socks it to them because they blame them for having unleashed this, what the Romans refer to as a disease germ upon the empire. And Nietzsche, the modern German philosopher, he blames the Jews, though he doesn't dislike Jews, but he says he thinks Christianity is a Jewish cult, which I don't think it is, as I think I mentioned to you. And he has, I think he wrote a treatise called The Antichrist, and trying to free Germans of Christianity and blaming Jews for perpetrating it on them. So once again, the Jews catch it in the modern world, and we know it finally happened in Germany as a result of all that kind of portrayal and agitation. So, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But you say, well, you're being an apologist here. Yeah, because I think they've got the short end of the stick, frankly, the raw end of the stick, and continue to do so. And even in the present world at the UN and everything else, when they're just trying to survive again, they catch the raw end of the stick. So, because they're up against a configuration of third world nations that have other interests in mind. In any event, be that as it may, these people, at least the ones in Palestine, were these agitators taking the people out into the wilderness, showing them the signs of either their impending freedom, depending on one narrative as Josephus puts it, another time he says redemption. Now, freedom, as I've told you, is a very important point in the letters of Paul. And I read you that material on covenant of Agar, which is Sinai. And the covenant of, we are the free born, he says. the Christians, we knew Christians, where the Jews are the descendants of the slave woman. But more anti-Jewish invective, like it or not, it is. If you were to butt a bit, if you were black or if you were Hispanic or something like that, and someone was saying that about your origins, you'd take it pretty negatively. So it's pretty negative, regardless of you say, oh, well, it's only arguments, only polemics, it's only symbolic. Yeah, but it has a bad psychological effect on people who hear it. And therefore, cast out the slave women. I could hear Hitler saying something like that, frankly, as a justification for the kind of things he was doing. In any case, in those allegorizations, as Paul admits they are, as I showed you, use the word that such things are allegory in the same thing. Freedom is freedom from the law. Freedom from the law of Moses, not freedom from Roman. But you see, when Josephus is talking about freedom, signs of their freedom, it's not freedom from the law. It's freedom from Rome and imperial domination. So you have a double entendre of the word freedom. And if you look at the Jewish coins in this period, I put them in my books on purpose. I have in this book here, this new one, I was very intent on doing this, because I think, many people don't even know the coins of this period. I have some of these coins. I actually put some of my coins down on the scanner and got a scan of the coins from my own collection. Came out pretty nice. But just quickly, here's one of my coins here, I think I scanned. Let me see if I can find it. I'm not having very good luck here. Hello, 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 where are you? Where are you going? Let's see. Oh, here it is. I put it in a lot of other interesting pictures. This is the coin back here, of my own coin, and it's coin from the year 2 of the uprising against Rome. That would be 68 AD. Depicting a ceremonial amphora on the obverse and a great leaf with the logo Freedom of Zion on the reverse. So, that was the thing that was moving then. Freedom of Zion. It's actually the logo on the coin of year 2 of the revolt against Rome. So freedom is not freedom from the law, as in Paul, but freedom from Rome. There's another of my coins that I scanned earlier in these pictures, aside from our, I think I showed you this, but I'm particularly happy about these pictures of our Cal State Long Beach expedition to the Judean Desert. This is an expedition where we made holes to see if these things were hollow here, like Cave 4, which was originally a hollow-out place. And this is the burial mausoleum. It says found by 2 CSULB students. One was a guy called Dennis Walker, who actually found it, and then Ron DuBay was along with him. They both got covered in Time magazine for that. They're representing me out there. And I mentioned them again, the burial mausoleum of the righteous teacher discovered 2 CSULB students. I thought I'd give CSULB as much plug as I could. And here's a lookout over the Kedron on the Dead Sea, discovered by my son, who was along with the expedition at one point. He discovered that, pictures of that. And then here, me, of course, the hotshot, standing in the cave during the radar ground scan. And then here, the first radar ground scan of the Cumberland Cliffs, carried out by the author together with the CSULB team in winter 1991-1992. Here's our radar ground scan. So if anyone says CSULB doesn't get covered internationally in books, here we are. There's our students here holding the ropes and everything. And here's another student doing the ground scan. And here's another student. This one is my son. Another one in the cave, 4, holding the ground scan box. And then here's more students. Left, the CSULB walking survey 1992, charting all caves from Qumran in the north to En Gedi in the south. Here's a very nice picture here with the students climbing up here along these cliff sides. Here's another student finding a lintel in a cave about 20 miles south of Qumran on these walking surveys. Here's some more students. There's Dennis Walker again walking up along through behind Hyrcania, one of the Herodian fortresses. So again, the 1990 walking surveying. So I tried to give Cal State as much PR as I could, because why shouldn't Cal State get as much exposure as Harvard? They don't do anything there. And they just coast on their name and the money big time donors give them. But they're no better than you guys. They don't even have the same energy a lot of you guys have, because you guys hold down jobs a lot and do your college education at the same time. So you don't have to. So my intent in often is to make it clear that you can be as good or better than them, and as I have been. And not my phone. Okay,
your phone. I didn't turn my phone
off. Oh, okay. I thought you were getting a phone call from Harvard or something here.
And I didn't get up to answer.
Anyway, look here. So I put these coins here. There's another coin back here, a Barcoppa coin that I actually, it was also from my collection, that we scanned and stuck into the eye scan. Here it is. Here's my coin here. That was right on, we put it right on top of the scanner. Scanned it and got that. And this is a palm tree of Bar Kokhba mentioning Shimon and the freedom of Jerusalem on the reverse. So that's the second Jewish uprising, 132 to 136. Freedom of Jerusalem. And then the last thing we have here is, of course, the Wailing Wall, the corridors of the priests that's still standing underneath the temple area near the Wailing Wall. Roman Colosseum, built with money stolen from the temple of the treasure by Vespasian, and by largely Jewish prisoners. Jews didn't build the pyramids, they built the Colosseum, where they then subsequently were some of the first to die in fun and games, which is something one never really hears much about. The Arch of Titus proclaiming his great triumph and of what he stole from there. And here's a picture on the Arch of Titus of the candle, golden candelabra from the front of the temple, which is on the Arch of Titus to this day, which they melted down in pure gold, given by a woman called Queen Helena of Adiabene. Now, all this is very detailed information that I'm sure, how many of this room have ever heard any of this before? Never. Nobody ever talks about it. Maybe you have, we've taken a previous class, but nobody ever talks about such things. You don't even hear anything like this. Because no one's ever doing an historical approach to these things. It's always what spiritual sustenance you get. You know, it's more like a sermon, which is good. There's nothing wrong with sermons, but if you want to do history, let's do some history. Let's get the people out there who deserve to be out there. That's what we're trying to do. Here is what's called, I chose all these pictures, so Judea Capta coin after 70 AD, when this guy, Vespasian, look at this big, you know, looks like a football coach, actually. Even tougher. That's what the Roman generals looked like. They were nasty pieces of work, you know, they didn't have any, the milk of human kindness did not flow from their veins, you know, they were people who came up through the ranks and, got their jobs by, fighting in close combat. You know, they're not like pussycats. Yeah. So when we get the centurion and the other thing that we read the other day, you know, this is what he would have looked like. This guy here. I wouldn't want to get near him, man. I wouldn't want to talk to him about Jewish dietary regulations either. Okay? Anyway, the other side is the Roman soldier. And it says Judea captive. And this is the Senate of Rome here, sitting over a weeping Jewish woman under the palm tree, which was supposed to symbolize Judea. And that's called but then here's a coin that I have here, which is from year 4. This is not my coin. Guy on the internet lent it to me. Free. A Jewish revolutionary coin from year 4 depicting the cup of the Lord and bearing the logo Redemption of Zion. So here's the cup you hear so much about on a coin from year 4 depicting with a logo not freedom of Zion here, but redemption of Zion. So that's what Josephus is complaining about.
So in year two, it was freedom of Zion?
No, no, that's going from both. This one has to be. No, it was interchangeable. Harut Zion is freedom of Zion and redemption of Zion. I can't remember the word. But anyway, no, it's not that. I mean, there are lots of coins. Some of the coins would have redemption, some of them would have freedom. But the point of the matter is Josephus interchanged the words too. And that's what he's concerned about. So this revolution is obviously, this war is being run by or engined by or inspired, pressed forward by these kinds of types and with this kind of ideology, which Paul is totally opposed to. Paul allegorizes it. Now Josephus, what's he? Is he totally opposed to this? Yes and no. He's a double agent. For a while he claimed to be one of the commanders in Galilee. As I said, you need commanders in Galilee like Josephus, you don't need any enemies. He's supposed to have been involved in the fortification of Galilee in the 66 period, and of course it collapsed immediately, his fortifications. And then what did he do after it collapsed? I told you what he did. But it's more specific than that. He knew some people in the Roman camp, he admits. How would he know some people in the Roman camp? Not because he'd been to Rome on that mission I told you about beforehand, where he'd met Poppaea. By the way, I have a coin in there commemorating Poppaea after Nero kicked her to death in 65. Because she was pregnant, kicked her in the stomach. Nice chat. This is what you want to do with your wives when they get pregnant? Kick them in the stomach? Yeah. Yeah. And then make a coin to commemorate them. Anyway, Josephus met her, and she sent him away with gifts, he said, because he said she was interested in religious coin. He said in his autobiography that he had gone to Rome on the part of some priest that had been arrested for a minor trifle. So Josephus was an aristocratic priestly circles of some kind. In any case, when he finally surrendered, he was in a cave, right? What was he doing in the cave? I told you this one. Yeah, well, what was the point? He was supposed to commit suicide. And they were drawing lots to see who would kill each other and then commit suicide. And so he says in a very sort of cagey way, he says what? Josephus and a friend drew the short straws. And so what happened? They proceeded to kill all the others who were hiding out in the cave, right? And then they went down and surrendered to the Romans. This is the kind of guy you really want to be on your side. This is the sort of person that you really feel is a good colleague. And then the first thing he did when he was ushered before Vespasian, and he really was ushered before Vespasian at this point, because he had friends. I say he laid the groundwork for this betrayal earlier in Rome when he went there. He was already playing both sides. These leaders in these kind of contexts were very superstitious. Caesar was very superstitious about the Ides of Rome and all that kind of stuff. Soothsayers. He came into Vespasian's presence before Vespasian became the emperor and said, "You are the world ruler who is going to come out of Palestine according to our prophecies to rule the world." He applied the world ruler prophecy from the Jewish scripture to Vespasian. How do you think Vespasian would like that? That would be a very flattering thing to have a Jewish priest posing as a prophet applied to you. So Josephus got favorite treatment ever after, didn't he? And he even got what? Adopted into the imperial family when they took over as Flavius. They were the Flavians. That's why he's called Flavius Josephus. And he had a pension for life, and I'm sure he had a nice apartment in Rome, and He tells how Titus, Vespasian's son, let him take prisoners down from the cross who were being crucified because they were friends of his and stuff like that before they were killed, before they died on the cross, stuff like that. Gets a nice wife and things like that. He tells it all in his autobiography, creep that he is. You say, Professor Eisenman, if he's such a creep, why do you rely on his work? Well, we can't judge a person's work because they're a creep or not. Paul's not one of my favorite people either. You judge it by the excellence of its material and content and so on. And his material is pretty encyclopedic. But you have to treat it with care. In any event, the same world ruler prophecy becomes the moving force behind what? Christianity as we know it. For Christianity as we know it, it's not Vespasian who's the world ruler, the Roman general. Underhand interpretation of the prophecy, obsequious interpretation of the prophecy. Tendentious, perhaps, is a better word. You know, my vocabulary is getting more and more lost in my brain as I go into dementia. or what's it called? Hobson's disease or something? What's that disease where
Alzheimer's.
People... Where they don't know where they are?
Alzheimer's.
As I get more and more Alzheimer's, my vocabulary disappears, so I can't remember tendentious, but most of you probably didn't even know the word anyway, so now you have a new word. Tendentious means to interpret things in a tending way towards something that you want it to be. So, the Christians, for their part, see the world ruler as Jesus, and it's another worldly kingdom and so on and so forth, and that has survived to 2,000 years. So Christianity, too, is answering to the world ruler prophecy. Now, the reason I read you those passages from John was because I wanted to show you that as Jesus is being presented right from the start in a gospel like John, he is one of these people. What people? Showing the signs, right? And Also, the Taheb is one of these people, clearly. Who's the Taheb again? The Samaritan. Now, here's a picture of Palestine there, Dead Sea, and so on, Jerusalem. Okay, so where's Samaria? Samaria is up here. Where's Galilee? Galilee's over here. Where's Golan? Up there. Okay? So, Samaria. Where's Caesarea? Here. Where's Jaffa? Here. Where's Gaza? Here. I've got a map in the back of my books. You can see it. Plenty of maps. So Samaria really is Shechem here, present day Nob. I told you the derivation of Nob was in the new city on the old city of Shechem. You wouldn't know it by looking at it, but I told you that Arabic doesn't have a P, it only has a B. So it's Neopolis. Neo is new, polis in Greek is city. And as it gets slurred down, Neapolis, Neapolis, Nablus, Nablus. What's another city like that? Constantinople, aimed at who? Constantine. Constantinople, Constantinople, Stanople, Stanople, Istanbul. Istanbul. No P in Arabic. That's how Istanbul, or that's how Constantinople becomes Istanbul. Okay? All right. So in any case, this Tahir is operating up here, and all the trouble is there, and he's crucified down here in a place called Lydda. In the book of Acts, Peter visits Lydda, does some miracles there, you will remember. Lydda is now the airport of Israel. It's called Lud Airport, where all the super jet liners, that's what's on the flatland below the mountains. And so the crucifixion is occurring here, in terms of the Pontius Pilate, Waterfield. Okay, so now, let us take a look at the beginning of the material in the Gospels. I'm going to use my harmony. If you have a harmony, use that. Or whatever. What are the two books you have? One is interlinear and the other is... Yeah, you have a harmony, right? Yours won't exactly agree with mine. And they didn't send me a copy of yours, the buggers. I'm going to try to make them send me a copy, but so far don't have a copy. So we'll correct each other as we go, okay? So we might as well start from the beginning, okay? The genealogies. I don't know if yours are if that's where you start or not, but Matthew 1:1-17, Luke 3:23-8. No, I guess it's we have the prologue in John's Gospel before that. That's a pretty familiar, John 1:1-18. This is pretty philosophical. I think we'll read it because we're doing John, so let's just get that out of the way.
What are we starting on?
I just said the prologue of John's Gospel 1:1-8 in my book. I'll follow my book because it's easier for me.
Spot on page 3.
Oh. You got it on yours? I wish I had that book, but they haven't sent me one yet. See how useful those are, to have them plotted out like that. I mean, if you don't have a book like that, you're really already difficult. You need it. You need an interlinear, in the sense that you can look up a Greek word occasionally. If you're really serious, I mean, if you just want to play games, well, you don't need anything. But if you really want to make a serious study of this throughout your life, and I think a lot of you probably do, I mean, this is the kind of thing you want to study when you leave school, just not just at school, and know about it, and it enriches your life to work at. So get these books, because you'll never... look, this book here. One of my students gave this to me when I first came to Cal State in 1974 or something. So I don't want this, Professor Eisenman, you can have it, it stinks, or something like that. I said, oh, okay. And I've used it ever since, because it was a Greek interlinear, and I've done most of my work out of what this student threw at me. You know, and I'll prize it because it's got all my notes and things in it. Pretty soon you take notes in it and things you've done one year, and you don't want to use any other, because once you've started writing in it, you've got all your previous comments in it, and underlinings and emendations, so it becomes a valuable possession. I've had it recovered even twice. So, and this book's falling apart, But I'm not going to change it, because I'd have to, transfer all the comments to some other book. And the same for you. You don't want to change what you start working in either, because that's where all your ideas are. Right? So get one. I see some of you don't have them. Don't skimp on important things. Only skimp on unimportant. Just don't go to dinner this weekend, and that'll be the price of at least maybe 1.5 books. Skip a Lakers game and you can buy 10 books. Or the Angels or some loser team like that. All right, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Hey, come on, this is not a Palestinian text. This is already philosophical, isn't it? Very abstract philosophical text. Mainly we call this Neoplatonic. It's a Neoplatonic text. Jews weren't writing Neoplatonic texts, I can assure you. They don't even think they know anything about Neoplatonism. Certainly Palestinian fishermen didn't know anything about Neoplatonism. So, I mean, I don't deny the beauty of John, but let's get real. We may not get a lot of historical information out of this. We may, and we may not. But I'm saying already it's written, what I would say, from overseas, right from the first word. And by a very sophisticated intellectual from overseas, I mean overseas outside the borders of the South. Doesn't have to be Rome. I would consider probably Alexandria would be where I would look for in a Neoplatonic. You say, what's Neoplatonism? This is Neoplatonism. The logos, the word, it's the essence of Neoplatonic doctrine. And you say, well, in Greek it's logos. What does it mean? I'm not a Neoplatonist. You know, you'd have to read all of Neoplatonic literature to understand what they mean. But Plato had the theory of the forms, the abstract theory of the forms, that they were in another universe, an ideal universe or something. And I think the logos, the word, is one of these important primordial forms in this other alternate universe, which is why it's called Neoplatonism, and so on and so forth. I wouldn't even want to begin to try to tell you. But this is Neoplatonic type of text. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And poetic, very poetic. It even reads nice in English. I'm sure it reads better in Greek. The same was in the beginning with God. So it's a duality, a dual universe, the Word and God together. So this logos of the Neoplatonists identified with the God of the Hebrew or something. All things were made by him, and without him there was not anything that had been made. That's very rhetorical Greek rhetoric. You know, what do they call it? Thesis, antithesis. All things were made by him, and without him there was not. So that's thesis and the antithesis. It might be some reciprocity too, but they call it thesis, antithesis. And in lyrical poetry, how did they call it? They called it my brain. You see, it's gone. There was one line one way, then it would reverse itself and go back the other way, and then a third line called the epod, and Paul uses that all the time in his writing, which shows. Quite a high training in Greek rhetoric, not Hebrew rhetoric. Greek rhetoric, not really taught in Palestine, I don't think, to any extent. And in him was the life, and the life was light of man, and the light shineth in the darkness. Light, dark imagery, very important for Neoplatonism, very important in the Dead Sea Scrolls, very important in Zoroastrianism. There came a man sent from God whose name was John. Okay, an historical note. The same came for the witness that he might bear witness of the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came that he might bear witness to the light. This is very poetic and very abstract. So Jesus now becomes identified with the light. John is the precursor of the light. This has been thought over very carefully by someone in a highly abstract manner. Right? And also poetic. People love this prologue of John. I mean, there's nothing wrong with loving this prologue of John. I mean, it's a very impressive piece of work. But I mean, we have to understand what it is. It's not historical Palestinian. You want to know historical Palestinian, you can see light, darkness type documents in the community rule at Qumran. I don't have time to read you all that. But the community rule has this light, darkness imagery, and the light is the sons of light. The darkness are the sons of darkness. This war of light against the sons of darkness in the Dead Sea Scrolls. The sons of light are the people in the community. The sons of darkness are all the people who follow the devil and Belial and are evil, and they have to be obliterated from the earth. Now, the sons of the scrolls are not kind. These are not peaceful essences, which is why I object to the idea of, oh, the scrolls are people just contemplative. No, this is contemplative. The scrolls are not contemplative. The scrolls are militantly aggressive. Apocalyptic documents. It doesn't mean they're bad or good. You say, why do you like them? Well, I just think that they're interesting. That's why I like them. Yeah, don't worry about it. That's just a forgery. Just a forgery. A modern contemporary forgery. But you can check it out if you want. Forget some guy down in San Diego, I think, wrote that. Called Skilly, I forget what his name is. Or another guy, he came from Europe and he was taught by some other guy. It was last century. There was the true light, even the light which lighteth. Look at all this poetry around light, 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 light. And this is what they like to do. Paul does this too in his polemics. Which lighteth every man coming in the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him. Once more, that swinging back and forth. You call that, your word for that was reciprocity. But I call it, God, I wish I could think of it in let me see, I think I have it. If I look up in my index quick, I think I can find it. If I look up epode, I can find what the other two words were. Or if you guys have a dictionary, you can find it. Do you have a dictionary that has the word epode, E-P-O-D-E in it? That's the third thing. Nah, I don't even have it in my index. Missed it. Anyone have a dictionary here? No. Look up epode in here. Do you have a dictionary on that thing? Oh, well, don't bother. Too much trouble. I'm not finding it. Anyway, there's two other things that come first before epode. E-P-O-D-E. They usually give it in the definition. Yeah.
Stroke?
Yeah, that's it. Thank you. He gave it to me. You don't have to bother. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hey, where'd you learn that?
Introduction to Poetry, I think.
Which one?
English Introduction to Poetry.
Oh, great. There you go, Strophe. So in poetry, Greek lyrical, Roman lyrical poetry is called strophe, antistrophe, epode. In philosophy, it's called thesis. This is what Marx loved. They call it the dialectic in the 19th century. Antithesis, synthesis. It's just clever rhetoric. Clever rhetorical devices. Well proven clever rhetorical devices. But highly trained, highly skilled. Now the person who wrote this, you have to understand, I'm not criticizing him or extolling him, just saying he's highly trained. And by saying he's highly trained, I mean by that he's an educated, highly educated, sophisticated intellectual of that time, and he has to come from somewhere like Alexandria. He did not, I am absolutely convinced, there were not people like this in Palestine in this period. Now, I don't think Jesus was like this. I don't think John the Baptist was like this. These are much more primitive charismatic teachers that we're talking about in Palestine. Do you see that, what I'm trying to say? This is very polished. Hope you can grasp that, what I'm trying to say. So what, you say? Well, that affects how historical it is. How much did such a person really know about the history? Or was he more interested in philosophical, making points above his opponents? So, he came into his own, and they were not received, and they were his own, received him not. Okay, that's the first of those accusations that we're going to encounter all the time, that the Jews rejected Christ. That's a very, as we put it, polite form of the accusations that the Jews didn't want Christ. He came to his own, and how does he put it there? He came unto his own, and they that were his own received him not. Who? This is not very great, David. Which of his own did receive him? The ruling class? Put in power by the Romans, objected to by the mass of the population, ruled over by Herodian Roman agents and Roman governors and priests, collaborating priests that the Jews themselves killed in the uprising against Rome and burned all the Herodian palaces. Ooh, what, we have a unified country here somehow? This is again, you see, simplified. Now you say, Eisenman, you're apologizing. No, I don't think so. I'm trying to make it real, not philosophical and idealized. So what do you mean his own? Wasn't Jesus killed because he was a popular leader? Why would he be killed if he wasn't a popular leader? Whoever wanted him dead, whether it was Romans or high Jewish priests or whatever, or Herodians, he was, we can approach him in any real way, and we can say there was someone like this who got into some trouble here, right? And the Gospels make it very clear that he's popular, regardless of the death scenes that they portray. And that he can take over the temple, stop commerce in the temple, the people will greet him with palm ferns coming into Jerusalem. There's all kinds of things like that. The high priest debate, better one man die than the whole people, and so on. There are all kinds of indications of great popularity. So what do you mean? What do you mean? What are you saying when you say that he came to his own and they received him not? Who? Which? That's, you know, if I were in a courtroom, I'd rip this to shreds. And this is the kind of simple thinking that you hear everywhere, of course. What is it really pointing at? I think it's pointing at Pauline doctrine. That the Jews rejected Pauline doctrine. That's a fair statement. And insofar as Pauline doctrine represented Jesus' doctrine, you could then make that next step. But I don't think historically that bears out in terms of the events that are being portrayed in Palestine in this prayer. And not just Jesus was popular in Palestine in this prayer. All these charismatic leaders had a popular following in this prayer. And that's what so angered people like Josephus. They didn't. Josephus' best friend was one of the high priests that was killed in the first days of the uprising. A guy called also Jesus. Jesus ben Gamala. And he talks about that in his autobiography. And in his Jewish war, he's very angry about that. Because Jesus ben Gamala and another guy, Ananus, ben Ananus, another high priest, are taken by the zealots, those he's calling zealots. Josephus makes fun of the zealots. These are the people that supposedly started the war against Rome. He portrays them as dressing up in girls' clothes and using lipstick and so on and so forth. I mean, it's a preposterous portrayal. Because he's so angry at them for killing these high priests that were his friends and his supporters. He talks about Ananus ben Ananus in the autobiography, but there he doesn't like Ananus ben Ananus. In the war, he calls Ananus the benefactor of the people whose death made it inevitable that the Jews would be destroyed. But in the war, in the Vita, he says Ananus was a cheater. He was in some olive oil scam with Ananus when he was up in Galilee. Ananus was down in Jerusalem in the earlier period, 66 period. Ananus isn't killed till 68. When the war gets into its, what I would call Jacobin phase or Jacobite phase, when it gets into its extreme phase. And they burn all the debt records from the rich versus the poor. They burn all the high priest palaces. They burn all the Herodian palaces. It's a real social revolution. That's why Josephus is really important. Not that he approves of any of that stuff. Now, what am I getting at? Why is Josephus upset about his friend? Well, the zealots take this Ananus, and along with his friend, both former high priests, who they obviously blame for something, and I think, well, clearly they stripped them. He doesn't say as much, but I think they urinated on them, and probably, what do you do when you mutilate dead bodies, desecrate their dead bodies, because he makes it clear that they did something bad to their dead bodies, and then they flung them naked out of the city walls, down in the valley below, without burial, as food for jackals. And he says that. Hey, Now, look here. That's why, am I wrong, you think, in reading to see if someone is maternal? I think you should do. You've got some serious internecine strife going on here. You follow what I'm trying to say? And that bears on the situation. What is going on here? How do these people hate each other so much? You know, why do they treat each other like this? It's like Baghdad. Yes, right? And then finally, bang, bang, bang in your head, who is Ananias? Ananias is the son of that Ananias who is portrayed in the Gospels as in the trial of Jesus. He's the high priest that is involved in the condemnation of Jesus, supposedly, anyway, according to the picture of the Gospels. And his son, Ananias, Ben Ananias, is particularly known for one other particular point. What was that? He's the high priest that arrested James, Jesus' brother, and trumped up a Sanhedrin trial against him on blasphemy charges or whatever, and had him executed by stoning. I think we have the cause of the antagonism to the Ananias family. What do you mean Jewish revolutionaries are angry at the same people that Christians are angry at? What does that tell you? And the Jewish revolutionaries are actually the popular party, and they throw this guy out of the city without burial as food for jackals naked, whether they urinated on him or whatever, I don't know. But I think they went that far because he says they upbraided his dead body in an impious manner before they did this. Both of these two, that Josephus' friend and this other guy, I don't think Josephus really liked this other guy. He was only upset about his friend. But then he said, this is the start. He said, because of these impious acts, he thinks God condemned the Jews to destruction. He said, just like the New Testament says. And that therefore they were, their temple, etc., was going to be condemned, and they have only themselves to blame. The exact same approach that the Gospels take on the Jewish mob, as it portrays the Jewish mob in Matthew, saying, his blood be upon us and our descendants in perpetuity. See, I contest these points on the basis that I think, which Jewish mob are you talking about? The establishment bunch who were hated by the mass, or the mass who was involved in movements like the Jesus movement and all the other charismatic leader movements, and was also involved in the war against Rome, and in the latter part were the poor against the rich and took over the debt records and burn the palaces and burn the high priestly and threw these priests out into the valley, those responsible for people like Jesus and people like James's death. That's why they threw them out, in my view, without burial. That's all. So that, to me, shows popular support. So I go back to Mr. John. He's writing this from overseas, I think, and has only a very superficial view of what was going on in Palestine. It's like having George Bush talk to us about Iraq, okay? I know, that should hit home for some of you. I think George Bush knows more about Iraq than this guy knows about Palestine. Anyway, leave it at that. So you get my point here? You can take it or leave it. I am not telling you these things for you to parrot me. I'm telling you these things to try to challenge you to make your own view, okay? Because this is how we're going to get to the history. Now, if you want to take this statement as authentic, you don't have to go any further. You got the whole story. So, it is as we've heard it, and so on and so forth. So we're going to stop with all those kinds of statements, and I didn't know I was going to stop there today, but we're going to stop there and discuss them. Anyway, but as many as received, but so you get what the implication of that particular statement is, right? But as many as received him, my translation may not agree with yours, and this is just what's given to me in this book, so let's not worry about the actual imprecise translation unless it differs markedly, okay? As many as received him, to them gave he the right to become children of God, even to them that believe in his name. Now that's interesting, children of God, sons of God, for the Jews in this period, all the righteous ones were sons of God. It's in, I think, the book of Proverbs, or one of those books, I think it's Proverbs. It might be in, I think it's Proverbs. you can look it up in a concordance, look up, you know, righteous ones, children of God, and you'll find the passage in the Bible. But in the Dead Sea Scrolls in particular, there are scrolls that make it very clear that as you became perfectly righteous, you become like a son of God. And the righteousness was very important to the Dead Sea Scrolls. Now, Paul is quite interested in who the children of God are. Is it the Jews through descent from the flesh, or is it some spiritual thing, children of the promise? Can you be an adopted son of God or son of Abraham or whatever? All these are floating around in the background, so that's an important statement. So they were not born, nor of the blood, nor of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. I think this is very close to Paul in Romans. So this is, to my again, already, if it's not parallel to Paul, it's Paulinized, okay, to some extent. So John and Paul are already almost side by side on this theological purpose. You say, what chapter should I read in Romans? Well, like read chapters 4 to 12, and you'll get all of Paul's things about those of the flesh, those of the spirit, those born of the spirit, and so on and so forth. Now, the interesting thing is that we'll see the synoptics, this is John, have God say, or the Holy Spirit say, as Jesus comes out of the baptismal, he's working on John and Jesus here, right, John here? The synoptics have a different approach. They don't have this material like this. They're not as philosophical. And John doesn't, I think, have the baptism scenario of Jesus and John that the synoptics have, right? You following me? So in the synoptics, they have Jesus go into the water and then a dove come down. Supernatural episode for sure. Dove representing the Holy Spirit or something. Again, allegorical to some extent. We'll come to it in a minute. So the synoptics have Jesus go into the water and a voice cries out. Is it the Holy Spirit or God? I forget which it is.
It's God.
Is it God? This is my only begotten Son, in him I am well pleased. Alright? So you see, the sonship motif is also involved in that one, too. But in that one, it isn't that everyone is the sons of God. It's just that Jesus is the Son of God at that point. Maybe people get to be sons of God, too, or children of God. Later, we look at the Greek. You have to check the Greek. Is it children or is it sons? I think it probably is sons of God here. Children makes it a more polite for feminist sensibilities, because children can mean male, female. The son's a little too masculine, perhaps, you know, for some people's taste. So you have to check your Greek interlinear and see what the word is there. I can't pull it out at the moment, but you can check. Okay, so you see, we get the flesh arguments here, and singular, plural children of God, in the synoptic singular. Son of God. Now there's one gospel that we know about from Jerome in the 4th and 5th century. He calls it the Gospel of the Hebrews. And he says in that gospel this was different. This says something to the effect, this is my only begotten, I'm not sure it even uses only begotten, maybe this is my son or something like that. At this moment have I begotten him. At this moment have I begotten him. Now if you look in your, I think if you look in your letter to the Hebrews, you'll find that is spoken of quite often, that particular phrase. It's out of Psalms. Let me see if I can find it for you quickly. That's the kind of thing we do in footnotes, if anyone wants to know what we want to do in the footnotes. Let's see, Hebrews here, where is he? All these markers just get in the way. Hebrews. Okay, here we go. Let me see if I can find it. One of those phrases where it says, yes, here's one. I got it circled. Hebrews 5:4. And no one takes this honor himself, but he is called by God, even as Aaron also. So also Christ did not glorify himself, become a high priest. But he who said to him, you are my son, today I have begotten. As he said in another psalm, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. And these passages are all in the psalms. So the Hebrews letter, I think, is implying that it thinks that's what was said about Jesus when he was baptized. What's the difference between one and the other? What's the? There's another reference to it here in Hebrews. Oh, here it is, chapter 1. Let me read it for you. In many places, many ways, God has spoken in times past to the fathers in the prophets. And in these last days, he has spoken to us in the Son, whom he appointed heir of all the world, by whom he has also made the world. And he was his shining splendor of his glory and express image of his person, and he was upholding all things by the word of his power. When he had purged our sins by himself, he sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, having become so much better than the angels. He was above the angels. He has inherited a far more excellent name than they. For to which angels, by the way, Muhammad in the Quran knows that, Christ is above the angels. For to which of the angels has he at any time said, you are my son, today I have begotten you. And I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. That's from Samuel, I think the other one there is about David. The second passage is from Samuel. And the first passage, do you have a footnote what that first passage is from? Psalm what? Some have footnotes. It's Psalm something.
Psalm 27.
Huh?
Psalm 27.
Is that what it's from? Psalm 27. Okay, so the other is from Samuel or Kings. I think that's from the other.
2 Samuel 7:14.
Yeah, you got some good footnotes there. Which one is that? Is that our harmony of the Gospels, or what is that? Oh, that's good, man. You got the right thing. You got it. You got everything you need there. Okay, so what's the difference between in him I am well pleased and at this moment I have begotten him? The other one abjures in at this moment I have begotten him, right? It speaks of an only begotten. It sort of rephrases it, right? In this moment I have begotten him implies that you become like unto a son of God. You're not really a son of God. You're a son of God when you become perfect. And what makes you perfect? The immersion in the purifying waters that finally cleanse you of all sin. The baptism preached by John. So as Jesus becomes perfect in body and spirit, he becomes, at this moment, in the waters I have begotten. It's called adoption as sonship. So that also accords to some extent here with John, when he says as you become perfectly righteous, you all become sons of God. It's, you understand why it's adoption as sonship? What should we call the other thing? Oh, I think the other thing is more like, the Roman emperor being a son of Jupiter or one of the gods, or Alexander being son of one of the gods, that actually begotten by one of the gods on human maidens and stuff, and that ultimately becomes the Christian position on the popular Christian on Jesus, which is popular positions are attractive. That's why they're popular. I have nothing against them. The question is, historically speaking, I think Palestine was adoption sonship. I think the Essenes were adoption. I think the Ebionites, James's group, meaning the poor, were adopted. I know that they were adopted. So that's considered in the Gospel of Hebrews, is where, in fact, it also has Jesus sitting down, breaking bread with James. Jerome also quotes that as the first post-resurrection appearance sighting. And it's James who wants to eat with him, like the two on the road to Emmaus in the Gospel of Luke, if you're familiar with that. In any event, I think the Palestinian, insofar as they're Christian or Essene or Bathing or Qumran or Jamesian or Ebionite, they go towards adoption of citizenship. And as you go west, it becomes more Greco-Roman imperial sonship. And you have to pick where you stand on that. I'm not a preacher. I'm a preacher, but not in that regard. I lay out the two possibilities. I tell you where I lean to, but you see where I lean to, so I don't tell you. But you have to decide where you lean. But you see, I didn't realize it was here in the Gospel of John, too, a difference. Anyway, let's go on. Believe on his name. Then he goes into his flesh material, blood, flesh, and so on, all type stuff. That gets him excited again about the Word. And the Word, because he's talking about flesh, so now he goes into the, and the Word became flesh. And dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, glory as of the only begotten. Now he has the only begotten in there from the other Gospels. He's put it there, you see. From the Father, full of grace and truth. You know, he's got both approaches. John bears witness to him, crying, saying, this was he of whom it is said, he that come after me, become before me. He loves these things. Come after, come before, for he was before me, and so on and so forth. These tongue-twisting sort of, you know, things that mystify you, conundrums or whatever. For he of the fullness we all received in grace, for grace for the law was given by Moses. Okay. Grace and truth came from Jesus Christ. So Moses is first, but then Jesus gave something out. This is a later than summary, obviously, sometime later. I would have to put this 50 or 75 years after the events in question, at least. No man has seen God at that time, the only begotten Son, which is the bosom of Father, he hath declared. So there's multiple contradictory things in here. Very poetic, very attractive, and of course people have always liked it. When I first was, I met some of these problems, some priests in Palestine, in Israel, Palestine, back in the 60s. One priest of French background, Dominican, said to me, don't you understand, Mr. Eisenman, or whatever he called me, you little worm, don't you understand that Jesus was not just talking the word, he was the actual word itself. So, you know, that really impressed me. That sounded tremendously impressive. I was like, wow, what's he talking about? That's beyond my comprehension. And I realized he was just talking about the prologue of the Gospel of John, you see. You know, and then he was trying to show me that, you know. And I, you know, for a while I wrestled with what he was trying to tell me on those kinds of things. But from the Dead Sea Scrolls perspective, I think as you become perfect, and they have the perfection ideology, in the scrolls, they talk about walking in the way of perfection, or they actually call themselves the perfect of the way. In Hebrew, Tamim Derek. Tamim is perfection. Tamim, the plural version of Tamim, the perfect of the way, is a name for their adherence, and the way is of course what they're giving. Now the interesting thing is, in the community rule, they do associate that with John the Baptist's gospel, with the coming of John, with the line in the Gospels that the Gospels associate with the coming of John the Baptist, that make a straight way in the wilderness. You know, highway for our Lord or something like that. And they interpret that in the community rule twice, as I've told you, as the way in the wilderness is what they're talking about, Derek, the perfect of the way. And in the book of Acts, when the Romans are talking about Christianity, particularly Felix, the book of Acts says, Felix knew a lot about the way, as if the way was an alternate name for Christianity at that time. And so the way is very strong language in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and they believe in the perfection ideology, but as you became perfectly righteous, you became like a son of God in the Dead Sea Scrolls. The hymns in the scroll say, you know, I have raised you on my lap, I have succored you, I have been a I am a father to all the sons of truth. It's a passage in the hymns that come on, that God is the Father to all the sons of truth. Multiple sonship, okay? Okay, quick here before you run. I know you want to go. Let's look at, I have a quick precedent before we get into Matthew and Mark's, Matthew and Luke's genealogy and then the baptism thing. This Luke 1:1-4, for as much as you have been taken ahead and draw up a narrative concerning these matters, we have been filled among us, even as they delivered them unto us, which from the beginning we were eyewitness and minister of the word. Seemed good to me, having traced the course of all these things accurately from the first, to write unto thee in order most excellent to Theophilus, that you might know the certainty concerning things where you were instructed. So Luke's beginning is just a narrative thing saying, I've compared a lot of different things. It does the same thing in Acts. Says the same kind of, I've compared a lot of manuscripts, and I think this is the best presentation of the thing. So Luke also shows himself to be highly derivative. Having looked at other writings on the subject, and he's addressing someone called Theophilus. Now, whether Theophilus is a real person or some abstract person or an imaginary person, what does Theophilus mean in Greek? Well, Theo is God and Philo is love, God lover. Is this a person who's a God lover? One of the many God lovers? Or is this an actual person called Theophilus? Nobody has ever. Some people say that the translation of John, Yohanan, God comforts, would be Theophilus. I don't know. I can't see that this is a person called John that he's writing to. I can't tell you what's going on. I can only tell you that Luke admits that he's comparing manuscripts. Again, that shows a later documentary approach. Now, you say, what about the title Luke? These titles did not get on the Gospels at the beginning, it seems. I don't know when Luke became associated with the Gospel of Luke, but Luke is certainly a traveling companion of Paul in the historical Luke. He's Lucas, a physician from Cyrene, which is in North Africa, Libya. That's who Luke is supposed to be. Where is he mentioned? In Acts. And he may be mentioned in Paul's letters. You'd have to use, I can't pull it out right now. Okay, you want to go home? Next time, we're getting a little moving. We're going to do the genealogies and the baptisms and the early life of Jesus. So we're getting along. What we got?